tonight. Amen. How's everybody doing tonight? Amen. That was horrible. How's everybody doing tonight? Amen. Amen. God bless you for being here tonight. I want us to do something. I know many of you have been asking about what we can do to help with the tragedy that's hit Moore, Oklahoma, and the tornadoes and stuff. I have several connections there of people that we've been talking to and just seeing what we can do. We're not going to do anything before this weekend. I think I've got it set up. The Assemblies of God, they have a ministry that they're connected to called Convoy of Hope, and it's a lot like Salvation Army, but they come in and they have all the resources, and they have the semi-truckloads of stuff to actually help the families. I've talked to several churches today, and they're really getting bombarded with just a lot of stuff, and they're having problems storing it. And so we're going to work on the next week or so of maybe putting a team together, maybe next weekend and going up, and we'll have the opportunity just to serve and to help feed the people and pass out clothes and even do counseling and prayer and just all these different things. And what we'll do is connect with other places. I know that some of you have already dropped some clothes off and different things. And so we'll do what we can in that part of it. But this is not something that's going away. This is not something that's going to be fixed in a week or 2 weeks. We're talking about years worth of rebuilding. And so we'll just be praying about that. And I should have all the information for you Sunday morning. What days we're going to be able to go, give you an opportunity to sign up for that. And if you can't go, maybe you want to give to that in some other way, that'd be great. But I want us tonight just to open up with a word of prayer. And I want us to specifically pray for the families that have been affected by this. And just, it's amazing to see the support and the love and how people can come together. And it's awesome to see the churches coming in and just, the church being the church. It's such a dark time and such a confusing thing. Sometimes things happen to us in life and we try to rationalize it and we just can't. It just doesn't make sense. And when it comes down to it at the end of the day, it's just not fair. But God never promised that life would be fair. God never promised that everything we face we would agree with and that we would understand. His promise is that he would never leave us or forsake us. And so if you and I stay faithful, God's promise is that he'll always be faithful. Amen. So we've all bailed out and we've all tried to do it on our own. And when things didn't turn out our way, we just kind of did it our way and thought, you know what, God, you didn't fulfill your part. So I'm just going to go. That's not God's fault. That's our fault. If we remain faithful, I heard somebody put it this way one time to me, and it's always stuck. They said this, God can pull you through anything if you can withstand the pull. He can pull you through it if you can just hang on. I know for me, this is the way it's in my mind, so this may not work for you, but this is the way I see it. How many of you, some of you are my age and a little older, do you remember any of you ever taught to water ski behind just an old outboard motorboat and really to slalom ski? And so the advice they gave you, the wisdom, is just don't let go. You hang on, and about the time you think you're not going to make it, just hang on for half a second longer, and you're going to come up. Now, how many of you are like me? You just about drown trying to, and you just think this is never going to work, and it's over and over and over. And then finally there's that one time where you actually hang on just long enough and boom, you pop up just like that. And everybody in the boat's going, see, I told you, if you hang on just a little, just like that, pop it. But you feel like you're going to drown. You think this is never going to work. This is dumb. This is not even fun. Sometimes in our walk with God, we feel that same way. We feel God pulling us through something. It just feels like we're about to go under, and we don't know if we can hang on any longer. Everyone's telling us it's going to be all right. Everyone's telling us that, hey, if you can just hang on a little bit longer, it's going to be great. When you get to the other side, but it's that feeling of, you know what, I don't know if I can take it any longer. If you and I will remain faithful, God will keep his end of the bargain. Every single time. And I don't know who that's for tonight. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know personally what you're struggling with. But there may be some issues in your life just personally, maybe with your marriage, your family, in your business, that you just feel overwhelmed and you feel like, I can't hang on any longer. If I hang on, I can't do it. My encouragement for you tonight is this. Hang on. Just hang on a little bit longer. God will get you through it if you can withstand the pull. He'll pull you through it, and when he does, it's almost immediate. Boom. It's just you pop up and everything is great. But it's that initial feeling of like, you know what, God, you've left me. You've forgotten about me. You don't understand me. You don't even know where I'm at. I don't know what's going on. It's just that if you can just hang on, he is faithful. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer tonight. Heavenly Father, we love you. God, I thank you for your word. Heavenly Father, I don't know who here tonight is struggling in their faith. They're struggling maybe physically in their body, maybe just in their family with their children, whatever it is, God. They're overwhelmed tonight, and they need you, Lord, in a real way. They need you to just show up, and they need you to pull them through this time in their life. Heavenly Father, I ask you right now, Lord, just to do what only you can do. Bring peace, bring love, bring direction. Just calm the storm. Lord, just have your way in every person's life here tonight. God, we just lift up the victims of this tornado in Oklahoma. Lord, we just ask you tonight, God, to let them feel your love and your peace. God, help us to be your hands and feet extended, Lord. I thank you for all the great ministries that are taking place right now that are ministering to them. But God, let's not let it stop in the next weeks, Lord. Let it continue for the months and years, Lord. Let the people understand and see that you are real. And it's through people and it's through their neighbors that you want to touch them, that you want to impact their lives. God, help us to do everything that we can, Lord, to be supportive. God, I just pray that tonight, Lord, every need here tonight, every family, every circumstance, Lord, every great praise report we have tonight, God, we just give you praise and glory and honor for it tonight. Don't let anything be said and done in this house tonight, Lord, that doesn't lift up and glorify your name. Lord, we're here to praise you. We're here to worship you in spirit and in truth. Heavenly Father, receive our worship tonight, Lord. I pray that it is pleasing to your ear and it is a sweet smell in your nostrils, Lord. God, I pray that you be pleased with your children tonight. Lord, we come here to worship you and to bless you for who you are and for what you've done. If you agree with that tonight, say amen. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap of praise tonight. Amen, 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 amen. Real quickly, just find a couple people. Just tell them you love them tonight. Would you do that? Amen.
Dark was the stain of my sin, evermore guilty within. A searching for rescue where none could be found, until from that hill I heard the sound. Until from that hill I heard the sound. At the cross, where there's room for me. And at the cross, I am finally free. At the cross, burdens rolled away. At the cross, oh, what a glorious plan. God reaching down to fallen man. All of us broken, lost, and undone. Well, here now as heaven bids us come. Well, here now as heaven bids us come. At the cross, where there's room for me. And at the cross, I am finally free. And at the cross, burdens rolled away. At the cross, sing after. And at the cross, where there's room for me. And at the cross, I am finally free. At the cross, burdens rolled away. At the cross, and at the cross, where there's room for me. At the cross, burdens rolled away. At the cross, at your cross, at your cross.
One more time.
At the cross, at the cross, where there's room for me. Finally free. At the cross, burdens rolled away. At the cross, I am finally free.
Bigger, sing it.
Lord, you're bigger than my sickness. You are bigger than my pain. You're bigger than my broken heart. You're bigger than my shame. You say you gave the best of heaven so you could hold me close to you. And even in my darkest hour, you say, take my hand, you'll make it through. And I know. You're my everything, Lord. You're my everything. ears to hear you. And give me eyes to see that all of heaven's singing with songs of freedom over me. Lord, I'm tired of dead religion. Fire. When you alone bring satisfaction, Lord, and you alone are my desire. And I know that you're my everything, Lord.
Come on, let's sing it out to him. Place you in that place tonight. You're my everything, Lord. Jesus, you're my everything. You're my everything. Jesus, you're my
Jesus, you're my everything.
Tonight your breakthrough could depend on one thing. Could depend on you stepping forward and say, Jesus, I don't care what else is going on in my life. I don't care how hectic it is. You're still God. You still created everything. And I placed you as Lord of my life. So in that tonight, Jesus, I'm going to worship you. I'm going to lift my voice. And I don't care who hears me and I don't care who sees it.
You're my everything, Lord. We worship you.
Come on, sing it to him.
Father, you're my everything. Yes, you are. You're my everything. You're my everything. You're my everything. You're bigger than my sickness. You're so much bigger than my pain. You're always bigger than my broken heart. Tonight you're bigger than my shame. 'Cause you're my everything, Lord. And you're my everything. Jesus, you're my everything. You're
line in this song that gets me every time, and it's because I deal with a lot of people that they can get past a lot of things, but one thing that keeps people from moving forward in God and moving forward in their relationship and even coming back to church is they don't believe that God is bigger than their shame. It's a lot of us that been in those places in our life where we we're just humiliated by maybe some of the decisions we've made. Many of you remember the story of the Good Samaritan. And the scriptures read that a certain man fell into the hands of robbers and thieves. And they robbed him, they beat him up. And the scripture says they stripped him of his raiment, which means they took all of his clothes off of him. And they left him there on the side of the road, beaten up, and they left him there, scripture says, half dead. Now, the important thing about that passage of scripture is this. There was nothing significant at all or of any value to his clothes. There was no reason to take his clothes. There was nothing to benefit them from robbing him of his clothes. They'd already beat him up, taken his money. The only reason they took his clothes and stripped him naked was to humiliate him. Was to completely strip him of any self-worth or any dignity that he had left. They left him there, beat up, half dead, and naked on the side of the road. Now, there's probably none of us in here that's found ourselves beat up and left for dead, naked on the side of the road. Maybe you have. Keep that story to yourself, all right? But we've all been stripped down emotionally, humiliated, ashamed of the decisions we've made, the places we've been, the things we've said, we've done. We've come into church, I'm going to do this, and then we're out and we're back in. And what happens is the enemy wants to strip us and humiliate us. He doesn't just want to kill you, but if he can humiliate you and he can defeat you right here in your mind, if he can make you think that everybody else thinks you're crazy, you're a loser, you've lost it, you're untouchable, you're unreachable, you're not even worth it anymore, he wants to strip you and humiliate you and put you in a place where you feel like nobody loves me. I can't even show my face at church. No one's ever going to accept me again. How many understand tonight that is a lie straight from the pits of hell? God is bigger than your shame. He's bigger than your past. He's bigger than any stupid decision that you've made. Any mistake. You say, Pastor, you don't understand what I've done. I don't have to know what you've done. I don't have to understand it. What you have to understand tonight and what I have to understand tonight is that he's bigger than all of that. And my heart, personally, as a pastor, where I pastor this church or any ministry I'm a part of, my heart and my goal as a minister is this one thing, that we never get to a point where the church is not in a place where it would welcome somebody at their lowest point. It has to be an emergency room. The church, this church, I'm talking about physically, we think of the church as these walls, but the church, meaning you and me, we make up the church. We make up the family of God. We are the church. And it should never get to a point because someone has said or done something that we never give them another chance. That's a great place to say amen right there. I'm so proud of our church and the people in this church that every single week, every single day, your arms get a little bit wider, your heart grows a little bit more, and no matter what happens and what takes place, we just continue to love people. We continue to believe in people. We continue, you know why? Because I want that for my life. Scripture says in the way that you judge that, also you will be judged. In the same measure that you dish that out, that goes in grace too. If you want to be real hard-nosed, well, you get one chance with me and that's it. Boop, boop, boop. That's fine. But don't go crying when you only get one chance. Well, you can't have it both ways. I wouldn't be here tonight if it wasn't for God's grace. And I hadn't done half the stuff some of you've done. How many are you thankful for grace tonight? Amen. Amen, amen, amen. I love you tonight. You may be seated. God is good, amen. And all the time, amen. Amen, 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 amen. Thank you for being in the house of the Lord. Now, will you give Jeff a hand tonight for leading us into worship? I can't tell you how many times, I know you think that Jeff and I work in here, that we would discuss, you know, what I'm preaching and what he's going to sing, and we would orchestrate all that. We purposely don't do that. I mean, there are times, just like before service, that I told him, sometimes I have an idea what direction I'm going for the next few weeks, but we don't ever get together during the week and coordinate and put our worship set together and our all that kind of stuff. It's amazing to me the way God can orchestrate that. And a lot of the times we purposely don't do that because we want to make sure that we're hearing from God. We want to make sure that we're being used of God. Amen. And I'm so thankful for the leadership of this church and for staff that I have that I know for a fact they pray. I know that they seek God. They don't take it just for a paycheck. And the reason why I know is because when we get ready to have service and certain things like this happen and time after time where the worship set is preaching my message before I even preach. And so that lets me know that he's praying and that he's in tune and that he's hearing from God just like I'm hearing from God. Amen. So you need to be thankful and be praying for your church and for your pastor and for the leadership of this church. If you don't do that, you need to do that, all right? I encourage you to do that. If you don't want to pray for me, pray for somebody else, pastor, okay? But pray for somebody, all right? Lift your leadership up in prayer. Be an armor bearer, all right? Be an armor bearer for the leaders of this church and for Sunday school teachers and everybody that's in leadership. It's needed, and I promise you I covet your prayers and I can feel your prayers because there's some days that I would like to be doing anything other than being a pastor of a church, amen? And I know that's probably not what you want to hear from your pastor right now, but I'm human just like you are. There are some days that I'd like to just run away and hide, and I want to call and complain and gripe about why I'm not getting my prayers answered, all right? Instead of trying to make you feel better about your prayers, amen? So pray for your leadership. Pray for your church. It's the best thing you can do, amen? Amen. Let's have Heath, if you'll help me out. Jeremy, if you'll help me out tonight. We're going to take up the offering tonight. If you've come prepared to give, I want to give you an opportunity to do that. I will let you know that we are about 17 bags short for the Backpack Buddy Bash tomorrow night. Many of you have already bought just groceries for this. It's around $20 to buy all the groceries. I don't even know if it's that much, but we're about 17 bags short. So 15? Okay, we're 15 short. I know many of you don't have, you may not have time tomorrow to do that or tonight to bring those, but if you could tonight, if you could say, listen, pastor, I raised my hand, I didn't get a chance to do it, that's fine, not a big deal, or you hadn't had an opportunity to do that. If you have $20 that you can give tonight, say, listen, just put this toward that, we'll go tomorrow and buy that bag. What we're doing tomorrow, it's the end of school bash for our Backpack Buddy kids. Around 120 kids are invited. We've got about 50 bags. We usually have about 50 show up to this. We'll be having free hot dogs and candy and water slide and bounce house. And then here in a little bit, at the end of the service, we'll be praying over a Bible, that every kid will receive a Bible from this church. And so if you want to be a part of that, if you can give to that tonight, that would be great. It'd be a great thing to invest in. Many of you have already helped pack these bags, and thank you so much for doing that. It's just an amazing ministry that we do every single week. And it's impacting kids, and I know they pray over it when they pack those bags every week, and you can't put a price tag on it. We can't measure what God is doing through that. There's no telling the impact that's going to happen 10, 15, 20 years down the road when these kids grow up and they have their own families, and they'll say, you know what, when I was in elementary school, I wasn't raised in the best environment. My parents didn't have all the money, but there was a church that provided food for me every single weekend, and I've never forgotten it. And they will find this church, and they will come back, and they'll invest in their families. You can't put a price tag on it. And so I'm so thankful for this ministry. I'm so thankful for the people who invest in it every single week. And so if you can give to that tonight, please do that. Please feel free to do that. I'm going to say thank you to the Bensons. They don't want me to, and I'll get in trouble, but I don't care. I've been in trouble before. They have given, and just they're just precious people. They had us, the staff, over today to eat lunch, and we had the most amazing enchiladas and homemade rice. And listen, if you're hungry, go to her house, all right? Listen, I'm hoping this comes out to be a weekly deal, and even bi-weekly, either way, it doesn't matter. If you provide food, I will show up every time, all right? But I'm so thankful for this family, and they've helped us so many. Brother Mike's helped fix things in the church and doing all kinds of stuff. They're just a blessing, and I just thank God for them, and I just thank God for the people we have in this church. Amen? Amen. Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you for this opportunity to invest in your kingdom. God, thank you for this time we have tonight to just worship you. God, I pray that you speak to our hearts tonight. Lord, let us apply it to our life. But Heavenly Father, we ask you tonight, Lord, to bless this offering. Use it, Lord, to further the kingdom. Jesus, we ask these things in your holy, precious name. And all God's people said, amen. God bless you tonight as you give. Amen. And even in my darkest hour, you said, take my hand, you'll make it through. You're my everything, Lord. You're my everything. You're my everything, Lord. You're my everything. Give me ears to hear you. Amen, 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 amen. If you have your Bibles with you tonight, if you have a Bible with you, turn to John chapter 15. We're starting something new tonight. We're going to be really just searching the scriptures and really taking some time on Wednesday nights and on Sunday mornings. I'm going to be focusing in on the Holy Spirit, and I'm going to be doing some teaching on the Holy Spirit, and I hope it's a blessing to you. I know it will be, but I'm just going to take some time. We're going to take about a month here on Wednesday nights and Sunday mornings, and we're really just going to get into the scriptures about who the Holy Spirit is and why you and I need the Holy Spirit. And I know that tonight, growing up, for me, growing up in a Pentecostal church and growing up in a pastor's home and really growing up in old school Pentecostal church, my experience with the Holy Spirit is going to be different than your experience from the Holy Spirit. Tonight, for some of us, when I mention the Holy Spirit, some of you are like, yes, you're with me. You kind of perk up. Some of you are like, oh, no. We've heard it, the Holy Spirit, and growing up for me, it was the Holy Ghost. I mean, so we start talking about ghosts, and it's like, what are we doing? What's going on? I can understand. I get Jesus, the Son of God, and I get God, who's my Father, but then we throw in the Holy Ghost and the Holy Spirit, and it's okay. I don't know what we're doing. What are we talking about? What is this? And we kind of tend to want to shut off. And sometimes we connect the Holy Spirit with speaking in tongues and when running and shouting and flopping and all this stuff. And so for some of you tonight, there's kind of a negative connotation to that. When I begin to speak on the Holy Spirit or mention the Holy Spirit, some of you, your experience has been, I don't know about that. And so we're going to talk about tonight. There's two things that we'll deal with over the next few weeks, and that's a lot of people are not even aware of the Holy Spirit. For some of us, it doesn't. We don't understand it because we don't know enough about it. And a lot of that is due to a lot of our churches. We haven't really taught specifically on the Holy Spirit and who he is. And so I want to clear up something tonight. He is not an it, all right? It's not a thing. The Holy Spirit is part of the Trinity. He's part of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. He is part of the Trinity. He is part of the Godhead. The Scripture refers to it and to him as a he. He is the Holy Spirit, and Jesus, we'll read here in just a few seconds, and we read it Sunday morning. Jesus, teaching to his disciples, said, I must leave so another comforter, so he can come, and one just like me. If you break down the Greek in that, the counselor, the Holy Spirit, a counselor is one who walks alongside, one who walks with you. And if you break it down, it actually means one just like Jesus, one that is just like him. It's part of the Trinity. It's part of God himself. And the Holy Spirit is here for each and every one of us. Now, it's Jesus didn't say, I must leave so the Holy Spirit can come so you can scream in tongues every time you go to church. Somebody say amen. Okay. Listen, I've raised Pentecostal. I'm filled with the Holy Spirit. I speak in tongues, and I'm not ashamed of it, okay? But I'm also here to teach you that there's so much more to the Holy Spirit. There is so much more to who he is and what he wants to be in your life and in your family, and the power that comes with that, the comfort and the peace. And when the scripture says that he will be another comforter, our counselor, he will be a counselor. He will be someone who will listen to you, someone who will convict you, someone who will instruct you, someone who will be right there with you. And so I think a lot of times we get a little worried about it because we don't really know who he is. Amen. And the second thing is, a lot of us don't know, we're not aware of the Holy Spirit and where he fits in. And the second thing is, a lot of us resist the Holy Spirit. A lot of us, we know exactly who the Holy Spirit is, and we have experienced him being in our life and being filled with the Spirit, but we resist him a lot of times because we feel him knocking at the door of our heart or leading us in a certain direction. Maybe he impresses on our heart little things like, have you ever had those mornings maybe where you get up or during the day and someone's on your mind? And you see come and you just feel this urge to call them or just send them a text or just Facebook them or just anything, and you just feel them on your heart, and you just little things like, it's so simple. That's the Holy Spirit leading you, and that's the Holy Spirit trying to push you in a certain direction, or standing in line at the grocery store, Walmart, and the cashier, you just know by the way she says hello or the lack of eye contact that something's not right, that she's having a bad day, that she's discouraged. Or have you ever been in a restaurant where it's obvious the nurse, yeah, that's weird, isn't it? It's been a while since I've been to one of those. So it's, you're at a restaurant and the waitress comes up and maybe it's her first day or the waiter, and it's obvious they're real frustrated and they're just feeling overwhelmed and they're kind of nervous and they get something wrong and they're apologizing. And I don't know how many times I've just stopped. I almost said nurse again. I don't know what to deal with nurses is. The waitress, and just I've stopped them and I've said, listen, you're doing a great job. You don't worry about me. You don't worry about us. You're doing fine. You're doing, and just little things like that. Now, we can take that and we can say, well, that's just us being nice. That's my personality. But I want to talk to you tonight, and my purpose for teaching on this for the next few weeks is this. God wants you and I to live a Spirit-filled life, not a spiritless life. Amen? You can go to church, and you can be involved in church, and you can live a spiritless life. This has nothing to do with being Assembly of God, being Pentecostal, being Baptist, Methodist. No. This is about living a Spirit-filled life. And when you and I operate in the Spirit, and we operate in the things of God, and we allow God to use us and speak to us, because let's get one thing clear tonight, all right? God saving us and our accepting Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, how many would agree tonight? That is a supernatural thing that has to take place. That is not of this world. You cannot go down to Walmart and buy you, I need to get saved kit. You can't buy that. You can't purchase it online. It's not something you can go to school for, and after 4 or 5 years, they say, you know what? Congratulations, Jeremy. You completed all the courses. You've done all the hours needed. You are now saved. Congratulations. You can now put that at the end of your name. No. It's not something you and I can do. It's something supernatural that takes place. that when we hit our knees or we bow our heads and we say, Jesus, I am a sinner. I confess that I need a Savior. I confess that you are Lord. I accept you into my life. Wash me clean. Take away all my sins. I confess my sins. You are now my Savior, and I will live for you. That is something supernatural that takes place. That's something that is not of this world. In the same way that you and I have to accept salvation supernaturally, it's the same way that instantly, I believe that the moment you're saved, the Holy Spirit now is within inside of you, that you receive the Holy Spirit, that the Holy Spirit wants to be active. It's up to you and I to activate that in our life, to be filled, to be completely filled with the Holy Spirit. Look in John chapter 15. We have read this scripture many, many times. And I want to ask you tonight, if you're new in your walk with the Lord and you're just getting started, or even if you've been in this thing your whole life, you should have John chapter 14, 15, and 16 highlighted like crazy, all right? You need to find the book of John, read the whole book of John. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are all good. But right here in John chapter 14, 15, and 16, there is a lot of good stuff where Jesus is teaching here. And it's a lot of confirmation for you and I about how important it is for us to accept Christ into our life and the power and the blessings that come with that. In chapter 15, we find here, these are some of my favorite passages of Scripture, but John chapter 15, verse 1, Jesus says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does not bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Look at verse 4. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. You skip over to verse 7 in the same chapter. Jesus again says, if you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be given to you. This is to my Father's glory, listen to this, that you bear much fruit. Okay? That you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. It's very important here. Look at verse 16. You did not choose me, but I chose you. This is Jesus still talking. I chose you and appointed you to go and do what? Bear fruit. Fruit that will last. You see, there's been a lot of people, and I'm talking from my experience right now, okay? I'll take you out of it. Being raised around church people, being raised in the ministry and around people who claim to be saved, who claim to be filled with the Holy Spirit, who claim to be of God. Listen, I've seen a lot of people doing a lot of talking, and I haven't seen a lot of fruit. You see, the important thing here Jesus is saying, listen, if you remain in me, I will remain in you. The important thing is, all of us here tonight, we have a desire, and we know that we're here at church and we serve God. There's an underlying reason for that, okay? If we'll all be honest for a second tonight. We serve God and we love God and we commit ourselves to God and we give in service and we give in money and we give of our time and we come and we fellowship and we worship God. But there's an underlying sense in all of us that we do this, not on purpose, but we expect God and we want God to bless us. We want blessings. We want things. We want our life to be better. We want our family to be better. We want our finances to be better. We want our health to be better. We expect, and it's not that we do it like a game, but there's in all of us, everybody be honest, we serve God and we make that change in our life. Why? Because we don't want to live in sin. We don't want to live in something that's hopeless. We don't want to continue to pour our time and effort and money or train our kids in a way in an environment that we know leads to destruction, that there's no hope in it. So inside of all of us, there's that desire to worship. Amen? It's in all of us. You can go to the darkest, most remote places in the world, and they may never heard Jesus or of God, but I promise you, they will be worshiping something. They may be worshiping a certain tree, a certain animal. There may be a certain place. When I was in Brazil, there were certain parts on the Amazon River. They have, in the Amazon River, pink dolphins. They have dolphins in there that are pink, and a lot of them believe that they're magical, that they have powers because, you know, hundreds of years before, one of their ancestors saw a pink dolphin and something happened and it changed their life. And so it has to be real, all right? So they worship that. And so you and I are sitting here going, that's just not, that's crazy. That's like us seeing a gray squirrel and being like, oh, I saw a gray squirrel. It's smaller than the regular squirrels I've seen. It's got to be. And we, why? Because they haven't heard they're going to worship something. There's inside of all of us. God created us in his image, and God is a worshiper. God is a jealous God, and he put inside of us that desire to worship something. And so it's up to you and I. That's why we live our life and we do what we do and we are commanded to go. We preached about it Sunday morning. So many times we're so content in where we're at that we don't want to move out of our comfort zone. We don't want to move out of anything that would make us feel uncomfortable or might put us in an awkward situation. And we know that God is leading us and telling us to go and encouraging us to go and impressing on us to go. But we're like, but it'd be just a lot easier just to sit here and I could just give the money or I could just, I tell you what, I'll request prayer for them, and that's the same thing, right? And then we get into, when we start doing that, we get into when the scripture says obedience is better than sacrifice. But sometimes we think, well, we'll just, instead of being obedient, I'll just do something else. My kids try to do that all the time with me. I'll tell them, hey, listen, go clean your room. Go clean your room. You got 10 minutes, blah, blah, blah. You have all done the spiel. Clean your, go do this. 10 minutes goes by. What are you doing? Well, I'm doing this. They get sidetracked. But Dad, I did this. That's not what I asked you to do. It's great. I love it. But you disobeyed. You didn't do what I told you to do. It's not the same thing. And sometimes with God, we do that too. God's saying, listen, I need you to do this. I'm calling you. I'm pushing you here. You've prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed for an opportunity to witness. And here it is. They live in the same house with you. I have the same last name. Oh, I'd rather do something else. Well, I'll just get someone else to do it. I'll volunteer and I'll get involved when my work slows down or my job here and I do that and I pay this off and we give this and blah, blah. I'll do this. And I'll tell you what, I'll volunteer over here. And we make these little deals and we sacrifice. Well, it's a sacrifice, and all God's wanting is our obedience. We find here, read it. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you want in my name and it shall be done. There's not a person in this room that wouldn't love to have that kind of authority and that kind of power when we prayed and when we asked God for things. We'd love to be able to change our situation and have the faith to believe that when we ask for it, God's going to do it. The problem is not God answering our prayers. The problem is what we're praying for. Closer we get to God and the more we get in tune with the Spirit, our prayers and our prayers begin to change. For people who are not saved and people who are not in tune with God and living according to the Spirit, their prayers will be something like this. Oh Lord, let me win the lottery. Oh Lord, give me $1 million. Lord, if you would just have somebody bless me with a new, how many are with me? That's not what this scripture means. It's not of ask anything in my name, it shall be done. Speak to this mountain, it shall be moved. Listen, it's not a get rich quick scheme, all right? It's you cannot manipulate God, amen? Scripture is very clear. God will not be mocked. Whatsoever you sow, that will you reap. And sometimes people, we think, have you ever had people do things and you think they're being blessed and you know they're not living right and you think, how come they're successful? What is going on? And Brother Mike, you mentioned it this morning. We're talking about, well, do you want your reward here or do you want it in heaven? Or do you want your punishment here? Listen, no, God will not be mocked. Even though we think, oh, they're getting away with it down here, every single one of us will stand before God and be held accountable for our actions and for what he put. There will be a judgment day. And sometimes we get wrapped up and, well, they need to. No, we need to worry about us. All right? It's important tonight that you and I live a spirit-filled life. The Holy Spirit is here for you and I. The Holy Spirit wants to live inside of us. And here's three things that he's going to do. This is just kind of an overview tonight of what we're going to be talking about and what we're going to be discussing. But I want you praying about these things. And I want you really seeking God and seeking the Holy Spirit to be active in your life. Because I highlighted in these scriptures that we would bear fruit, that we would bear much fruit, that the fruit that we have would last. Because the fruits of the Spirit, Scripture says, it's by our fruit that we will be known. Amen? It's by your fruit that you'll be known. You can say you're an apple tree all you want. But if you have bananas hanging off of you, you are a banana tree. You're in denial. Okay? And everybody knows it. They can see it. Why? You have bananas hanging off of your limbs. You are a banana tree. You are not an apple tree. But I want to be an apple tree. I don't care. Your fruit says different. And that's why you have people saying, but I am a leader. No, you're not. No one is following you. You're just taking a long walk. You're not leading anybody. You are not a leader. I am compassionate. You don't have any friends. No, you're not compassionate. I'm always positive. No, you're not. You're not. I'm happy. I'm always happy. No. You frown all the time. You're in denial. Scripture says we'll be known by our fruit. And the only way for us to produce the fruits of the Spirit and to have love and peace and joy, long-suffering, patience, the fruits of the Spirit, you and I know people tonight that are connected. I have people in my life. I don't question whether or not they're a Christian. I don't need to ask them. You can usually tell within being in the room with them 5 minutes. Why? Because the fruits of the Spirit are obvious. You can tell by the way they smile and the way they conduct themselves and how they greet you and the encouragement that comes out of their mouth. You can tell almost instantly, hey, there's something different about them. There's something that's being activated. They're living a Spirit-filled life. If you can hang out, if you want to, you can go to the funeral home and just watch the different families that come in, the different families that deal with tragedy and deal with loss. You can tell the families that have faith, and you can tell the families that have no faith, that have no relationship with God. Why? Because it's panic. There's no fruit, there's no love, there's no joy. More importantly, there's no hope. This is it. There's nothing to lean on. I don't want to live a spiritless life. I want to live a Spirit-filled life. I want a life that the Holy Spirit is active in my life, and that the three things that the Holy Spirit comes to do, and we read it Sunday morning in John chapter 14, He comes to comfort us, He comes to counsel us, and He comes to convict us. Oh man, we all jump on board when it comes to the comfort and the counsel. All right? Lord, send your peace, send your guidance, send your direction. Holy Spirit, guide me. Holy Spirit, lead me. Holy Spirit, give me the words to say. I don't know how many times I've prayed that for me as a minister. When I face situations and I have to walk into a hospital room or I have to walk into a funeral and I have to stand there and I have to say something that is going to bring some kind of peace or comfort, or I get a phone call saying, Pastor, this has happened. What am I going to do? I don't understand what is taking place. And I just begin to pray in my spirit, Holy Spirit, give me the right things to say. Lord, use me in this time to bring some kind of direction, some kind of peace, some kind of comfort to this chaotic situation. You talking about a helpless feeling. I sit across from people and they're like, Pastor, fix this. Okay. They didn't teach me this in Bible school. This is not a class they offer. There's not a whole lot. There's nothing I can do in a situation to make you feel better about your marriage or your finances or raising your children. And it has to be the Holy Spirit. It has to be our counselor, our comforter. You see, the unique thing about that is he has all the answers. You would agree tonight with me that over the past 20 years, there has been a rise in psychiatrists, counselors, marriage counseling, family counseling. There's been a rise in prescription meds that to help with all of that. The last 20 years, all of that has increased. I'm not preaching against that tonight, okay? I believe all those are great. I believe all those have their place as long as you've given God the opportunity first. Amen? We all agree with that. I'm not preaching against that. The reason why we reach out to those, because so many of us, there are times in our life, I've been to a counselor. I've had to do that. I've had things happen in my life that I needed to talk to someone. More importantly, just I needed them just to listen. There's something about that. There's something that's needed. And the funny thing is, Jesus thought about that 2,000 years ago. He told his disciples, I'm sending someone. I have to leave so that the Holy Spirit can come and dwell among you and dwell inside of you so that he can be your counselor and your comforter. Now, we sign up for that, and we're okay with that. He comes to counsel us. He comes to comfort us. He gives us peace. He's there, that presence that we feel. We seek that. We've been in services. We've been in at our home in times where we've asked God to show up, and he does, and we feel him there. We know he's there. We know that we're getting back to that there's something supernatural taking place, all right? It may be doodads or goose pimples, however your hair, if you have hair, stand up on back. Jeremy, you and I had to go to goose pimples. So it's something, you know, it's something different. You know, it's like this is God. That he's here. He hears my prayer. And I don't know how. And I've heard, and you've heard the testimonies of so many people. And you've said it. I don't know how I got through it. It was only by the grace of God that I'm even here today, that I'm even in my right mind. I don't understand it. Why? Because the Holy Spirit came and he was your comforter. And he was your counselor. And he was able to listen to you and the groanings of the Spirit deep down inside of you that you don't understand. Those moments, and you've had them, when someone has made you so mad, when your husband makes you so mad, and you're like, you don't even know. The worst thing in your brain is not even close to what you want to call them. There's not a word bad enough to, there's nothing there to explain what you feel in here. Ladies, you know what I'm talking about? You're just like, and you just, you can feel it. It's like, you can't express it, but you feel it here. Scriptures call that the groanings of the Spirit. It's in here. It's in here, in that deep part of our spirit and in our DNA that connects with us emotionally. The Holy Spirit wants to connect in a way, and that is where your prayer language comes in. Your prayer language in your prayer time, and when you're praying and seeking God, there is a heavenly language that will come to you, and that communicates. That communicates the groanings of the Spirit. It's aligning you. It's a language. It's an unknown tongue that only God understands. And he communicates in here. It makes sense. It enables you to communicate spiritually things in our life that we don't, it just doesn't make sense. God, I don't understand. I know you're real. I know you're in control of this situation. But God, my heart is broken. I'm frustrated. I'm confused. I'm broke. Nothing makes any sense. I'm just, and that heavenly language allows us to be able to communicate with our Heavenly Father. It's the communication. God comes, the Holy Spirit comes to comfort us, counsel us, and the third one is He comes to convict the world. Now, this is usually the one part of the Holy Spirit, one of His personalities that we do not like. He's always trying to tell me how to live my life, sticking his nose in where it doesn't belong. Just about the time you get set down to watch that movie or you're sitting in that movie, and about the second F-bomb that goes off, you get sick to your stomach and you think, what am I doing? I need to walk out. Why am I not walking out? I'm watching this movie. Now I can't even tell anybody I watched this movie. I can't refer to anybody who watched this movie. I'm going to have to lie now when they say, did you see this movie? I don't go to the movies. So, you know, and then all these, when it would all been settled, had we just got your tail up, when the Holy Spirit said, hey, what are you doing? You don't want to be watching this. It's not good for your walk with God. It's not, you don't need to hear these words. You don't need to even be here. Best thing to do is just get up, walk out. He convicts. All right? Those little things like that. I mentioned it just a second ago. A lot of us, we don't really know a whole lot about the Holy Spirit. Second thing is, a lot of us just resist the Holy Spirit. We know plenty. We know exactly who He is and what He's trying to do in our life. And we love the comfort. We love the peace. We love the counseling and the assurance that goes with it. But the conviction sometimes is a little tough. When He comes in and begins to convict us of what we're saying or what we're doing or the company that we're keeping or the conversations that we're having or the environment that we've put ourselves in, listen, I've gotten to the point now, I know immediately, I mean, it's like someone kicks me in the gut and I know, whoa, it's the Holy Spirit begins to move and convict and it's like, oh, I don't need to be here. Oh, stop telling me. Stop talking. Don't get thee behind me, Satan. Stop talking to me about that. Stop. The closer you get to God and the more you flow in a spirit. Listen, we're talking about living in a spirit-filled life, not a spiritless life. Because in a spiritless life, you can sit and listen to someone badmouth someone else and it don't bother you. You can sit and watch a movie and you can justify it by saying, I'm in the oil field all the time. I hear cussing all the time. That's fine. But you don't have to go pay for it. And you don't have to purposely pump it into your brain. Whether you say it or not, doesn't matter. Bad company corrupts good character. That's scripture. It corrupts you. There's not an oil field guy in this room this morning, or not this morning, tonight. There's not an oil field guy here tonight that's worked in oil field around it and doing it right now that wouldn't tell you right now, you know what, Pastor? I can't stand my environment. But I don't like being around all the cussing. If that could change, boy, my life would be easier. Why? Because they're trying to live a spirit-filled life. Heath, I have a hard time believing that you're home and you think, man, I can't wait to get around a bunch of guys that all they do is cuss every other word. I don't like being here with my beautiful wife that just brags on me and talks sweet to me all the time. And this may be a dream he's having. I don't know. But I'm speaking those things or not as though they are right now. All right? I'm believing in faith. Nobody seeks that. Bad company corrupts good character. To live a spirit-filled life, there comes counsel and there comes that comfort and there comes that peace and that assurance that I'm saved and that God is in control and that I'm doing the right thing, that I'm going the right way, but also comes conviction. And when the Holy Spirit convicts us, now we get back to the obedient side of it. We have to be obedient. When He convicts us, we need to respond to that. All of us want that in our life. We want to get closer to God. We want a better relationship. But boy, sometimes when we're convicted of our sins, we're convicted of our actions, it's really hard to be obedient because it's humiliating and it's degrading. And sometimes we feel like we messed up and we missed the mark and we're not worthy. And that's where we get back to the shame and we get back to the enemy wants to bring up your past and he wants to bring up all your failures and everything. Have you ever noticed that the enemy never talks about your future? The enemy's never telling you how great things are going to be. And no, he wants to bring up everything that you've done, wants to take you back. Hey, remember when you were back here? You didn't have all these problems. There's never any hope, never any peace, never any future in that. The Holy Spirit is in here, is for us. Jesus ascended into heaven so that you and I could receive the Holy Spirit. Part of that, there's so many things that come with living a Spirit-filled life. The fruits of the Spirit that become active in your life. Scriptures, Paul talks about it, that against these there is no limit, talking about the fruits of the Spirit, which means you're not restricted to just having one or two. It's God's will that all the fruits of the Spirit be active in our life, that we live a life that bears not just much fruit, but good fruit. Fruit that when people see our life and they see our actions and they hear the words that come out of our mouth and they are around us, it is obvious to them and to the world that there's something different about us, that we are living according to a different standard. More importantly, it's this, that there's something supernatural about our life. It was always amazing to me growing up. My friends that I had, that they didn't serve God, they didn't know who God was, their parents didn't serve God, they cussed, they got high, they got drunk, they did all these friends that I had. When they would come home with me, they'd come to my house, they'd walk in the house, and immediately not one cuss word would come out of their mouth. They would knew my dad was a preacher, they knew that my mom was a school teacher, they knew I went, they would walk in the house and everything was, "Yes, sir, Mr. Harris. Yes, sir." Everything began to change. Why? There was something different in that home. They knew what was going on. I had a good friend of mine, Jeff Anderson, my best friend in high school. We were playing ping pong one night, and we had a ping pong table in our back patio and covering and thing. And my dad and I would play till 2 or 3 in the morning. I mean, it was just intense. And my dad would get mad and throw the ping pong paddle and rip the net off of it. And my dad didn't like to lose, all right? So very competitive. I get that from my dad, all right? I watch, if you haven't gotten, I will recommend this movie, Parental Guidance. If you haven't seen that with Billy Crystal, go rent it. Go buy it. It'll be the funniest movie you ever watch. It's great. That movie I related so much because my dad didn't believe in everybody gets a trophy and all. No, you need to learn to lose. It's part of growing up. It's part of life. And I'm going to, and he beat me in every game he could. There was no letting me win to boost my confidence, all right? Well, none of that. So when I got to where I could beat him in ping pong and basketball and arm wrestling, I did it. And I didn't apologize for it. And I bragged. And that's why today Kara says, "You're not a sore loser, you're a sore winner." So Kara didn't play anything with me because I just rub it in. But anyway, they would come in and my best friend was playing in ping pong and everything. And I mean, he missed a shot and boom, out come a cuss word. "Oh." And my dad said, "Boy," he said, I said, shoot. "Mr. Harris, Mr. Harris, shoot. I didn't say that right." And me just going crazy. And my dad just starts laughing because immediately he knew. I mean, it was like, whoa. He knew he wasn't supposed to be saying that. He knew he was in an environment where it wasn't acceptable. Why? Because there was fruit there. There was fruit of something different. I pray that that is in my house and in my life. And I pray that it's in your life. And in your family, in your house, that when your kids' friends come to your house, I want them to be just a little bit thrown off by me. I want them to know there's something different there. He might actually be for real. He might actually cast a demon out of me. I don't know. He knows God. I mean, there's got to be something there. There's got to be fruit. Part of living a Spirit-filled life. It's allowing the Holy Spirit to be inside of you. Let him be your counselor. Let him comfort you. But also let the conviction come. When he convicts your life, be obedient to that. And the more you're obedient, the more you tear those, the more Spirit-filled you become. The more of the fruit that is active in your life, the closer you get with God. It's faith comes by hearing. It's praying, reading God's word, listening to God's word, listening to worship music, Some of you know what I'm talking about. Some of you, just putting worship music on changes everything. Putting praise music on and changing what you're listening to. Country music all the time, and everybody's cheating and drinking and partying, you know, and just, whee, it just, it, you know, that's, you know, listen, I like country music. I mean, that's probably my secret addiction. I like country music. I like country music. I do. But when you listen to that and you listen to certain, it just, it kind of gets in, you know, it's just part of you. And you listen to rap music and everything, you know, you got hoes and doing all this stuff and you got all the, I mean, it's just all, you just, it starts to, it is, there's something to it. You're laughing because you know it's true. Listen, the other day, the other night at the Rangers game, they started playing the theme song to Rocky Heath. Man, I was ready to fight. It's like I was 9 years old again. I could see Rocky and fighting Ivan Drago, you know, get him, Rocky, yo, Adrian. I mean, it's just all pumped up and he, jump roll. I mean, it's just the music got me ready to go. I mean, you know what I'm talking about. It's just that quick. Listen, it makes a difference in your life. If something so stupid as that can take me back to a time, I also can hear some of the old songs and old hymns, and they begin to sing them, and it takes me back to when I was a kid in revival service at Royal Rangers and camp, and all, just it almost transcends you. It almost translates you back to that time instantly. You relate to that. And we want to say, well, music doesn't. No. Why wouldn't it? Satan was the worship leader in heaven. That's his specialty. If he can't do anything else, he can lead worship. And he can cause confusion in worship. He can. He can make it to where you sit out there and you don't worship because you don't like the song. We've sang this 3 weeks in a row. I didn't like it 3 weeks ago. I don't like it today. I don't even understand it. It doesn't even make sense. It's too fast. It's too loud. What's going on? Why is another new song? Blah, 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 blah. And guess what you're doing? Not worshiping. Not worshiping. So who wins in that? You don't. God doesn't. Satan does. Because you're distracted. Here's the deal. Here's my philosophy. When you start paying admission at the door, you can gripe about the entertainment value. Okay? When you start getting charged 30, 40, 50 bucks a ticket to come hear me preach, you can gripe all you want. All right? When you start paying to come listen to worship, you get after it. Let us have it. But until then, you come here to worship. Because I prepared my message to honor him, not to honor you. Brother Jeff prepares his worship set to honor God and bring glory to him, not to make you happy. All right? That's, we're here to worship him and to leap so that we can live a spirit-filled life. Amen? Stand.